Sunday School Lesson Review. Welcome to the Sunday School Lesson Review hosted by the pastor of New Bethel Baptist Church, Brother Lars Jordan. The subject of this week's lesson is, Rejoice, in all circumstances. The scripture reading is coming from Philippians 1, verses 12 through 21. Please, don't forget to subscribe to our channel. After you click the subscribe button, make sure you click the notification bell for future lessons.
Hi, I'm Brother Lars Jordan, pastor of the New Bethel Baptist Church, located at 2729 Oak Grove Road in Hattiesburg, Mississippi. And today our Sunday school lesson for January the 20th, 2019 is Rejoice in All Circumstances. Rejoice in all circumstances. And one of the topics for this also is good from bad. Our Bible scriptures today are taken from Philippians, the first chapter, verses 12 through 21. And that is also where our background scripture come from for this particular lesson. And we're still in this area of study, this theme of our love for God. And our unit of study for this month is loving God by trusting Christ. Loving God by trusting Christ, trusting in what Christ has done for us, we show our love or demonstrate or illustrate our love for God. Love, this wonderfully powerful word that is actually the word that the Apostle Paul said it is the fulfillment of the law. Jesus Christ himself becoming the very word love himself. God is love. 1 John 4:8 tells us, and Jesus Christ being the Son of God, being love also. Not just what love does and what love will do, but is love. God is love, and he loves us. And as we said the last time, that the song that we learned as children, Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. And some might say, well, when did the Bible tell us so? Jesus told us that himself there in the gospel according to St. John, the 3rd chapter and the 16th verse. He tells us that for God so loved the world that he gave, because love wouldn't handle the situation. God gave what it would take to deal with the situation, his only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, to die for our sins, that whosoever believed that, not all the other things that we put, people want a 10-step program, but God didn't give you a 10-step program. He gave you his Son. He gave you his Son. He didn't tell you all the things that you have to do. He simply told you, Jesus Christ told you, everyone else wants to give you the program, but he told us to believe. If we believe that, he said, shall not perish, but have everlasting life. That is what it takes. And there's no way you tell people all of these things and give them all these rules, regulations, and restrictions, and they can't add up to them. They can't find them. And one of the reasons that we can't hardly reach out as a church now and bring others into this wonderful light that we're up under, being Jesus Christ, is because we make people think that it's so hard to get there. The Holy Spirit is the cleanser, and he cleanses us after we have been called, after we have become saved. Then he cleanses us from the inside out. As we've stated many times before, you can't clean a fish before you catch him. When the Lord gets us, then he begins the cleansing process. Man want to clean people up, but they had to wait for the Lord to clean them too, through the person of the Holy Spirit living on the inside of them. But our lesson today, rejoice in all circumstances. Sometimes things can get hard, and it can get difficult to rejoice in the circumstance. We all can relate to the the account of Joseph, the son of Jacob, with his coat of many colors, or his coat of big sleeves, where his brother had finally ultimately sold him into slavery, and then he became the second in command in Egypt under the Pharaoh. And when his brothers were found before him and they were apologetic, he let them know that you meant it for evil, but God was working this out for your very good. Sometimes things are working for good. The gospel could get held up if only one person was preaching it. But look what would happen through the life of the Apostle Paul. Now he is in prison. Rome has caught him, put him in prison, bound him between Roman soldiers that had duty for about 6 hours, and then a couple of more soldiers would come and chain their cells to the Apostle Paul. But it was a blessing to them to be chained to the Apostle Paul, just as it was a blessing for that centurion soldier to be stationed there at the foot of the cross, could not leave the foot of the cross because this was his job. But there at the cross, he first saw the light, and it was the Lord blessing him even at that time, till he shouted out with his own mouth that truly this is the Son of God. See, it's the burdens of his heart at that day, I'm sure, rolled away, just as the hymnologist would say. So our lesson today goes into Philippians. Paul in prison. He's writing this to that church at Philippi. That church that didn't have many Jews, but it had people that wanted to work on behalf of Jesus Christ, wanted to be there for his program. There would be some people that were starting to lose hope and lose strength and become apathetical because the Apostle Paul was locked down, this great pillar of the church, this strong man, this wonderfully powerful man. Verse 12 tells us that I would that ye should understand, brethren, our believers, our brothers and sisters in Christ, that the things which has happened unto me have fallen out rather unto the furtherance of the gospel. These things that happened to me, they have made the gospel reach out further. When it was with me, it could only stay right here. It only stayed right here. It's hard sometimes. Jesus let the apostles know that they would be persecuted. Times would get hard. He even let them know at one time that after they have killed the body, what else can they do? That's all they can do. But the Apostle Paul is saying here that the things that are happening to him, him being locked down in prison, is only advancing the word of God. It's only pushing the gospel message farther out there so that others can receive Jesus Christ also. The Apostle Paul is telling them to stay in the fight. Don't worry about me. This is not about me. This is about Jesus Christ. It was the Apostle Peter and the rest of the apostles there in Acts, the 5th chapter, where they had come before the council for still teaching and preaching Jesus Christ and him crucified, and they actually had a talk with them and told them to stop doing that. And the 29th verse of the 5th chapter of Acts said that they told them we ought to obey God rather than men. And they took counsel in the 33rd verse how that they would slay these guys. But remember, that was someone that was on the scene at that time. That was a doctor of the law. There was a Pharisee that taught even the Apostle Paul about the word of God, giving him and teaching the Pentateuch, the Old Testament scriptures and the prophets, those things that were from the Old Testament. That doctor of the law, he told them, he had counsel with the council. He told them that, hey, if we go out and take these guys down, remember what happened to these other sects that came in before these groups that came in and established, and people, they had their leaders that were over them. Remember how once that big guy was taken down, it just washed out. He said, but look at these guys. He said, if they're not real, in the 39th verse of the 5th chapter of Acts, he said, if they're not real, they'll be taken down. But if we try to take them down and they are real, then we are fighting against God himself. And we can't do that. So he was teaching them and giving them some good instruction. So the word of God, those guys left there happy to have been persecuted for the Lord's sake. And the next verse in the sixth chapter of Acts tells that the disciples were multiplied. In other words, now the word of God, because these guys endured the persecution, now the word of God is being multiplied. Now more disciples are being brought on the scene, more learners of the Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. So Paul says that me being in prison, this imprisonment, it's only furthering the gospel because others are looking. And he would actually say that. He says this in verse 13, so that my bonds or some would say chains in Christ are manifest in all the palace and in all other places. Because of this message that he has, this message, the gospel, or as we would like to translate, the good news. How good is the news? Here is how good the news is. Jesus Christ lived a good life before us, a perfect life as a perfect man. But the gospel message is that he died on the cross, was put in a borrowed tomb, buried, taking our sins far away, and then rising again on the third day, defeating the final enemy that man just couldn't conquer. And now that message, that good news, on the front of the newspaper that day, Jesus has arisen. That is the message. And because of this message, the Apostle Paul bound down to the soldiers here in the palace. These Praetorian soldiers are the Imperial Guard, these special elite soldiers that he would have to be tied to. They had to be tied to a man that was simply going to share Jesus Christ with them, the gospel message, what he had done for them. And I would say to you that when they were sitting there tied to him, some might say that they wouldn't be anxious for their next shift. But I believe that every now and then someone would be touched by the word of God and they can't wait till their time to get chained to this apostle and hear some more about this man, Jesus Christ. But he said that while I'm in bonds here, I'm teaching and preaching to these palace guards, to people, and even in other places around this city and this temple, this area here, this palace, getting this message out to other places and just telling them about Jesus Christ. Why he's here at this place, may as well share Jesus Christ. Verse 14 says, and many of the brethren in the Lord wax confident by my bonds and are more bold to speak the word without fear. Now, there are many other brethren that because they see Paul's situation and how he's not giving up, how he's still determined to share Jesus Christ, even in his bonds, they have gained confidence and want to go out and actually preach and teach more themselves about this man, Jesus Christ. And look at this. The last part of that 14th verse says, without fear. They're going to do this without fear. Remember, it was this same apostle in the sixth verse of this chapter. I know it's not even in our background, but he said, being confident of this very thing, that he that has begun a good work in you will perform it unto the day of Jesus Christ. The Lord is going to perform. He's going to reach out. The gospel message is not going to be stopped just because you stopped me, because you stopped one person. The world is still going to be set on fire by the gospel message. Someone is going to take it. Someone is going to receive it. And the gospel message, if that one receives it, he go out and tell two more about Jesus Christ, is going to help advance the gospel message. And now these guys are more bold to speak. Bold. In other words, they can't shut them up by just telling them, just as the apostles we told you about in the fifth chapter of Acts. You can't stop them just by telling them, because at this point they realize that they ought to obey God rather than man. And the motivation and the work of a believer is to share Jesus Christ, is to reach out and bring in more out of the darkness into this marvelous light. It may not seem that lightful for you as a believer while you're being persecuted, but trust me, there is nothing that can separate you from the love of God. He has you, and when you get to that area, you start doing this and sharing Jesus without fear. Verse 15 says, some indeed preach Christ, even of envy and strife, and some also of goodwill. Now, some had feelings of discontent against the Apostle Paul because he being big in the church, at this pillar of the church. Some were kind of covetous of where his position, where the Lord had advanced him to. And that is one of the things about envy. We want what someone else has, their possessions. We want to take it. We kind of subtle with it. But this envy was not just regular envy. It was also tied in with something that was a competitive thing, strife. It had strife, which strife means to stir up. To stir up what? Stir up this competitive nature in a person to try to make themselves look good by tearing down another. And some of them had goodwill, the Apostle Paul says. Some of them, they preached Christ. He said they preached Christ. They preached Jesus Christ. That was the main thing, to preach Jesus Christ. In other words, they were giving out the gospel message. They just were doing it for the wrong purpose and the wrong reason. He didn't chastise them at this time about that. He just told them that they did preach Christ because that would be the most important thing. And then verse 16 says, and one preached Christ of contention or selfish ambition, not sincerely, supposing to add affliction to my bonds, the apostle says here. He said, one preached Christ of contention. He preached it. He was giving out the message. But he in that message, he had selfish ambitions in it. He was trying to promote himself even more than Christ. Yet Christ, in the midst of that message, some type of way, was being preached. And in the midst of a bad message, sometimes people can receive Jesus Christ because they will grasp just that which the Lord wants them. His word will not return unto him void. So if they jump over there and they hit part of the word, somebody might hear that word and get saved through that word, even though that person have selfish ambition, like kind of like a politician when they shake your hand. They're trying to get your vote. And that seems to be what the Apostle Paul is talking about here in these people. They're trying to preach to increase their own influence and supposing their afflictions. Supposing to add affliction to my bonds, Paul said, trying to knock him down or hurt him in some type of way to promote themselves. And that's the way a lot of times people do. They use it someone else as their staircase. They will tear down another person to lift themselves up. Verse 17 says, but the other of love, knowing that I am set for the defense of the gospel. Some do this strictly out of love. Those that we talked about of goodwill, they do this out of love. They're seeing the Apostle Paul being imprisoned here. They are knowing that they've held up one of the great leaders of the church, even though he's sharing the word to the guards and to the rest of the people around the palace and this area. But now they're saying that the word of God is being stopped. So let's go out in love and continue to share the word of God. They know that he is set up for the defense of the gospel message, the telling people about Jesus Christ and what he has done for them and his love for them. Verse 18 says, well, what then? Notwithstanding every way, whether in pretense or in truth, whether they're pretending to be a preacher, a teacher, a leader in the church or sharing the word, are truly giving it out. He says this, Christ is preached. The Lord can use a donkey to preach his word, to get his message out. So he says here that Christ is being preached. He's being brought out. Even that person, I've been around many people in my day that couldn't read or write. A good friend of mine, I did his eulogy a couple of years ago. I sat down with him several times and we'd be talking about the word of God. And when he talked, even though he couldn't read or write, you'd almost get the feeling that he had sat with Jesus before personally. I know it looks like I'm just being speaking hyperbole, but not in the physical, but definitely he had some moments where he had spent with the Lord or talking to the Lord, and the Lord had encouraged him in a special type way. So Jesus Christ is preached. Even though he couldn't read or write, he had learned enough through the listening of other people preach and teach about Jesus that it hit his heart in a way to where he could even share Jesus Christ with others, even though he didn't have the capacity to read or write himself. He had a powerful message. And wherein I therein do rejoice. Yea, and will rejoice. I'll rejoice even though some are in pretense and some are in truth. He said, I'll rejoice because Christ is being preached. That's our plan. That's our purpose. We want Christ to be preached. He said this in verse 19. For I know that this shall turn to my salvation through your prayer and the supply of the Spirit of Jesus Christ. He says, for I know that this shall turn to my deliverance, or being freed from this situation. Now, I know in the KJV it says salvation, but this salvation is not talking about the actual saving work of the cross. This is talking about a man that is physically locked down in a prison and tied down between two guards at all times, tied and chained to them in bonds, cannot get away. But yet he believes that he's going to be delivered from this situation one day. That's the salvation that he's talking about. Now, understand that he was a person that understood that the deliverance could come in the form of death. And he's going to tell us that here in just a minute. So the next thing I would say after that word salvation is how. He said this. This is how it'll turn to my salvation. He said, through your prayer. When you ask a believer to pray for you, it's okay. It's good to ask others to pray for you. Pray for yourself. But I'm telling you that there gets to be times where you may not even know how to pray for yourself. But there are believers that you have prayed for that may know how to pray for you at that time. And you should always be praying for the leaders of the church. He said, this is how, through your prayers, but also here, he says this, and the supply of the Spirit of Jesus Christ. The supply of the Spirit of the Lord is working also on my behalf. The Apostle Paul said in there in Romans that he prays with groanings that we can't even utter, even though we try to sometimes, but it's some that we can't utter, but our spirit, the Spirit that's living on the inside, the Spirit of God, the Spirit of Jesus Christ, he prays for us also. Verse 20 says, according to my earnest expectation and my hope. Hope is a big word, and earnest expectation helps us understand hope. That is hope right there. It is an earnest expectation of coming good. Things that are going to happen that are going to be just right and good. That in nothing I shall be ashamed, because I've been sharing the word of God. And now I'm locked up for sharing Jesus Christ, for telling about his death, his burial, his resurrection, the good news, the gospel message. I'm locked up because of that. He said, but I am here because of that. I'm not ashamed, that in nothing that I will be ashamed, but that with all boldness. Remember, he talked about the boldness of those that got bold when they saw that he was locked down there in the 14th verse. He said, but that with all boldness, as always, so now also Christ shall be magnified in my body, the physical body, while I'm here in bonds, or whether it be by life or by death. Now, that word magnified, I have it underlined and highlighted because it's such a big word in this 20th verse of Philippians, the first chapter. It's something that means there's no way that you and I can make Christ bigger. It's something like if we were to look at one of the biggest stars in the sky, and we look at our sun, which can hold 1,300,000 Earths in it, if it was hollowed out. But there is the Hercules that can hold Antares inside of it, and over 100 million of them. Which our sun could go into that one so many 100,000 times. It just makes things, it doesn't make Hercules bigger, but it does when we take out our Hubble telescope. When the scientists take out, the astronomer takes out the telescope, he doesn't make Hercules, that star out there, bigger. It's already the size that it is. But when he puts that telescope on it and he looks, it does magnify it. It does show him something about it. When we begin to teach and preach about Jesus Christ, we can't really make Jesus bigger because he's already the greatest. He's already died for our sins. He has already defeated the final enemy. The things that he's going to do in that prophetic book in Revelation, those things are to be, but he even at that time will be the one that has been that appears to have been slain before the foundation of the world. We can look forward to the book of Revelation and know these things are coming to pass about this man Jesus Christ. And when we teach about him, we can't make him bigger, but when we live a life, when we continue to teach and preach about him, we do magnify him before people. While we're living and while we're satisfied and content, even in our bonds, that Jesus Christ is being magnified in the way that we live. We can't do anything to make the sun bigger or Hercules bigger. We can't do anything to make them bigger, but when we put a telescope on them, we actually magnify them, just bring them closer to us. We want to bring people closer to Jesus Christ. We can do that in our bodies at this time, in the way that we live, in the way that we teach and preach. And the Apostle Paul, even there in bonds, was going to share Jesus Christ, whether it be by life, he says here, or by his death. He'll take the death part if that's what was going to be here that the Lord wanted to happen. He was going to even submit to that. He says here in verse 21, the last verse of our lesson today. Hope I didn't confuse us that I got excited about verse 20. It says, but verse 21 says, for to me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. Now, in the original Greek text, is not there, as Dr. McGee would point out. Is not there, so it actually reads, for me to live, Christ, to die, gain. For me to live, it's going to be about Christ. In other words, the Apostle Paul says, my life is all in his hand now. Everything I do, I want to uplift and magnify Jesus Christ. I want to lift up his name before people so that they can trust him as their own Lord and Savior also and be brought out of darkness into light. He said, but if he wants me to stop at this point, when I get there, when I die, it's only gain, because all I'll do is get more Jesus, more time with Jesus, be able to be around him all the time. To be absent from the body, he said, is to be present with the Lord. So for me to live, Christ, to die, gain. So all of these things he says here, he would rejoice in whatever the circumstance is, whatever the Lord wants him to go through, is going to be good from bad. There's going to always be some good that comes out of that bad situation. The Lord can work it out. He is the one that saves. Let's read this and understand this and love the Lord because of what he's doing for us. We can love God by trusting Jesus Christ. Father God, we do thank you today for the study of your word. And Father, we pray that you will help us to rejoice, even in the midst of the worst circumstances, knowing that if we'll just keep our eyes on your son, Jesus Christ, you said that's a place you'll keep us in perfect peace. Keep us in perfect peace, peace, Lord. Lord, we do pray that at this time that you will search our hearts, forgive us of sin. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you for joining the Sunday School Lesson Review. Hope to see you next week. God bless you all.